point estimates, and sampling variability. We'll cover several topics in this video, starting with point estimates, what they are and how we use them, sampling error and bias. We'll introduce concepts of sampling distributions of a point estimate and discuss its properties. We'll discuss the central limit theorem, when it applies to a sample proportion in particular, and what happens when it doesn't apply. And finally, how the ideas that we'll discuss in this video apply in other applications. Let's start by considering an example. Suppose we take a random sample of 780 American adults and find that 45% of them approve of the job done by the US president. While the estimate might not be perfect, we would expect that 45% is a pretty good estimate of the approval rating. But does this mean that exactly 45% of all Americans approve of the job done by the US president? Not necessarily. Samples can have error as well. There are two main categories of uncertainty in point estimates that we're going to consider. The first is sampling error, and this is error resulting from the randomness in the sampling process itself, and much of statistics is focused on understanding sampling error. The second is bias. And bias is a systematic tendency to over or underestimate the parameter. Bias is critical to keep in mind, especially during data collection. If data is collected in a haphazard way, then any bias in the sample may be impossible to correct. Next, we'll consider the support for solar energy within the United States. Let's imagine that we've perfectly determined that 88% of US adults support the expanded use of solar energy. In this case, the parameter of interest is p equals 0.88. Here, p is representing the population parameter, which is, in this case, the proportion of US adults that support expanding the use of solar energy. If we were to poll 1,000 US adults and ask them if they support the expanded use of solar energy, what would we observe if the true proportion is 0.88? We can answer this question with a simulation, which is only possible because we know the actual support for expanding solar energy is 88%. Here's how we might go about constructing a simulation. Since there are 250 million American adults, we could take 250 million pieces of paper, write support on 88% of those pieces of paper and not on the remaining 12%. Then we take those 250 million pieces of paper, mix them up, and then we pull up 100 pieces. This is like taking a simple random sample from the population of 250 million American adults, and then we look at the fraction of the sample that say support. So do you want to volunteer to construct and run the simulation? This would be pretty intense with 250 million pieces of paper, so it's really not feasible, or at least reasonable to complete. But instead, we can use a computer. We can construct a simulation using a computer program that's just four lines of code in the statistical software called R. After running the simulation, we find that 894 of the simulated responses were support. So our point estimate is going to be 894 divided by 1,000, which is 0.894. And we're going to represent this sample point estimate with p1 hat for representing our first simulation of p, and we put a hat on it to represent that it is the sample proportion. Now this sample wasn't perfect. We know that in our population, the true proportion is 0.88. So in this case, this sample had an error of 0.014. We can run more simulations by simply rerunning the code multiple times. If we run it a second time, we get 0.885, and that has an error of plus 0.005. A third simulation, 0.878, so an error of negative 0.002. A fourth simulation, where p4 hat is 0.859, and in this case we had an error of negative 0.021, and so on. We've modified the program to run that code 10,000 times, and we've taken each of the different sample proportions from those 10,000 runs, so we have 10,000 sample proportions, and we've plotted them here in a histogram. This distribution is called the sampling distribution because it's the distribution of sample point estimates. If we take the mean of the distribution, it is 0.88, which is exactly what our actual population proportion was. And in this particular case, the standard deviation of this distribution is 0.01. And if we take a look at the shape of this distribution, it has a bell shape to it, and it's symmetric. And it should look familiar. It very, very much resembles the normal distribution. This is no accident, and this is a result of what is called the central limit theorem. In short, when we take a sample where the observations are independent and the sample size is sufficiently large, that sample proportion p hat tends to follow a normal distribution with the mean of the true population proportion and a standard error corresponding to the particular formula shown here. The standard error is a new term, and it basically just corresponds to the standard deviation of a point estimate. We use the term standard error to differentiate between when we're talking about point estimates versus when we're talking about the standard deviation, which corresponds to individual observations from a population. You might look at that second condition noted on the first line of the central limit theorem. The sample size is sufficiently large. And you might wonder, what does that mean? What is sufficiently large? And that's an important question. And fortunately, there's a guideline for that. In order for the central limit theorem to hold for a sample proportion, the sample size is typically considered sufficiently large when the sample size times the true proportion is at least 10, as well as the sample size times 1 minus the true proportion is at least 10. And this is called the success-failure condition, and it's something that we typically check to determine whether the sample proportion can be reasonably modeled using the normal distribution. Going back to our solar energy example, we can first check the independence condition. And we do this by noting that the sample was a simple random sample. And when we take a simple random sample from a population, the cases in our simple random sample are in fact independent. So this first condition is satisfied. And this simple random sample condition is often what is used to satisfy the independence condition. The second condition is the success-failure condition. And in this case, we take our sample size, which was 1,000, multiply it by our true population proportion, which is 0.88, and that's 880, so that's at least 10, so that one's okay. And we also take 1,000 times 1 minus 0.88, so 1,000 times 0.12, and we get 120. And that one is also at least 10, so the success-failure condition is also satisfied. And what that means is that we can be confident that p hat can be modeled using a normal distribution. Now let's also use the central limit theorem to compute the mean and the standard error associated with the sample proportion for the solar example. As we discussed before, the mean is the same as the population proportion, which is 0.88. And we can also calculate the standard error. And here we are able to plug in the 0.88 for p in each of the two spots, and also plug in the sample size, which is 1,000. And if we run through that formula and compute it out, we get 0.01. And this is exactly what we actually observed in our simulation as well. How often is the sample proportion within 0.02 of the true population proportion for the solar example? Let's start by writing down the information that we already have. We've confirmed the central limit theorem is actually satisfied, so the sample proportion p hat can be modeled using a normal distribution. We also found the mean and standard error of p hat, which were 0.88 and 0.01 respectively. And this means we can model the sample proportion p hat using a normal distribution with mean 0.88 and standard error 0.01. And this is just a normal distribution exercise problem at this point. And like any normal distribution problem, the first thing we should do after writing down the information that we have is actually draw out the picture. So here we've drawn out the picture with the center at 0.88 and shaded the area of interest, which is from 0.86 to 0.90, since that's the region within 0.02 of the true population proportion. Next, for a normal distribution problem, we want to find the z-scores corresponding to those two cutoff points for the shaded region. So z1 for 0.86, That's going to be 0.86 minus the mean, which is 0.88, divided by the standard deviation, or standard error in this case. And that is negative 2 for z1. And likewise, we get 2 for z2. We could use statistical software to determine that each tail area is 0.0228, and that's going to give us a central area of 0.9544. That is, about 95.44% of the sampling distribution for p-hat is within plus minus 0.02 of the population proportion p equals 0.88. And it's important to note that this is specifically true for this example. So if our population proportion was a different value, or if we had a different sample size, then we might get a different result looking at the fraction of the time that the sample proportion would be within 0.02 of the population proportion. Let's step back and consider our solar energy example again. Earlier, we had claimed that 88% of US adults supported expanding the use of solar energy, and that population parameter was actually based on a sample. In the real poll, which was done by Pew Research, 1,000 US adults were sampled, and a proportion, p hat equals 0.887 of them, supported expanding the use of solar energy. And this is more typical of what actually happens in the real world. We generally don't know the true population value. And instead, we take a sample, and we want to use our sample to estimate what that true population proportion is. So now we have the situation where we no longer have the true population proportion, but we're still going to want to understand the standard error associated with our estimate. When we go to compute the standard error formula, we hit an issue, which is that we're dependent on the true population proportion to compute that formula. Based on the principle that our point estimate is a pretty good estimate of the true population value, what we can actually do is do an approximation here and plug in our sample proportion in place of the p or population proportion value here. And going through the calculations, we end up with 0.01. This idea, or this notion of using a sample value in place of a population value in a formula as an approximation, is called the plug-in principle, and we'll use it in several other cases in future sections as well. Next, we're going to consider more about the central limit theorem and when it applies. This grid of histograms represents different sampling distributions under different scenarios. Each row represents a case where we have a different population proportion. So the first row is representing the case where we have a population proportion of 0.1. The columns represent cases of having different sample sizes. For example, the third column represents the instance where we have a sample size of 50. And we're looking at these distributions to try to get some sense of when does the central limit theorem apply and why does the success-failure condition make sense. So for example, if we look at the very left column, in this case, the success-failure condition is actually not satisfied at all. In this case, we have either skewed distributions in the first, second, fourth, or fifth case, or still in the third case, we have a very discretized distribution. That is, the distribution has a lot of jumps within it that are very, very evident, and is going to be impactful on using the normal distribution as an approximation for this distribution. If we go to the second column, we see that there's still some skew in some of the distributions. So we still have skew in the first distribution and the last distribution, and still even a little bit of skew in the second and the fourth distributions. However, in the third case, where p equals 0.5, we are starting to see something that looks more like the normal distribution. We're starting to see a bell-shaped curve, and we're also starting to see that the jumps from one bin to the next are not actually that large anymore. And so this distribution, while certainly not continuous, is starting to appear to be more continuous if, say, we squint our eyes a bit. If we go to the third column, where we have a sample size of 50, We can still see a little bit of skew in the first and the last plots. We no longer observe any meaningful skew in the second and the fourth plots. And in the third plot, we again have a symmetric distribution and one that's starting to, again, if we kind of blur our eyes a little bit, look more and more continuous. And if we look at the success-failure condition, we actually have the second, third, and fourth cases all satisfy that condition. And so these would all be cases where it's reasonable to use the normal approximation for the sample proportion. And it's important to highlight that it is an approximation. The normal distribution is a continuous distribution, and we're using that continuous distribution to approximate this discretized distribution. And again, that approximation tends to be reasonable when the success-failure condition is met and the individual observations are actually independent. If we jump to the case where we have a sample size of 100 or 250, we again start to see that all of these distributions now are no longer skewed and they all are actually reasonable for using a normal approximation. The distributions are getting tighter. And what that means is that in a larger sample size, it does make sense that our point estimates would tend to be more closely aligned with the truth than for a smaller sample. So if we look at, say, our case of sample size of 25 and a population of 0.5, we have quite a bit of uncertainty. So the variability of that sampling distribution is relatively large compared to when we have a sample size of 50, 100, or 250. And in general, the larger the sample size, the tighter the distribution for the sampling distribution. And that just means that our sample estimate tends to be more often closer to the true value than if we have a smaller sample. One last idea we want to emphasize here is that what we've talked about so far in this video actually extends out to other estimates as well. So for example, if we want to estimate the average number of years of education of US adults, we could take a sample and compute a point estimate from that sample as our estimate of the true average number of years of education for US adults. The ideas of point estimates also apply to differences. So if we wanted to estimate the difference in student debt for students at a community college versus a state college, we could take simple random samples from each of those colleges, compute the individual point estimates, and then compute the difference of these point estimates as our overall point estimate of the difference between the true debt for students at the community college versus those at the state college. To recap this video, we've covered point estimates, what they are, and how we go about using them. We've also discussed sampling error and bias. Importantly, we've introduced the concepts of the sampling distribution of a point estimate, and we observed when the sample proportion, p hat, is nearly normal. We discussed the central limit theorem and what the sampling distribution looks like under several different scenarios, and we also discussed how the ideas of point estimates apply far beyond sample proportions. The mission of Open Intro is to make educational products that are free, transparent, and lower barriers to education. Each year, teachers save students over $1 million by using Open Intro resources over expensive alternatives. We hope you'll join us at openintro.org.